So now I shift to English to give a very, very warm welcome to Fosbury Architecture, our first lecture, official lecture of this Milano Art Week. And let me introduce Alessandro Bonizzoli, Nicola Campri, Veronica Caprino, Giacomo Ardesi and Claudia Mainardi. Welcome. They are all Politecnico di Milano graduates, so I think it is really a super interesting opportunity and event to host you here tonight. Two of them are still in the school, Claudia and Nicola. And also, as Art Week was born in 2013, also Fosbury Architecture, 10 years ago. So happy birthday for your 10 years. And I just want to say two words. I mean, I don't want to make a history of the work, a biography, but just two words to say why we are so happy to have you here now. The first one is this one, that I think it is so interesting to be in the same place where you studied, where you learned, and to be here again to learn together with students and with the teachers. After a nice story, which I follow a bit, so after graduation, you all start working together as a collective, but also in several parts all over the world and Europe. And then, if I remember correctly, you thought to coming back to Italy to work together in a more together more. But then lockdown and COVID happened, so again some difficulties in the idea of starting a young new firm in a new way. This is another important thing we will deal in during the Art Week about the condition of working in the architectural field now. And then this incredible opportunity of being the curator of the Italian Pavilion at the Venice Biennale. So, a very institutional thing, very important thing, very representative thing, for the first time held by a collective, for a first time held by a young collective. And so, what a responsibility. And then you worked, as often did in the past, with the teams that are so close with what we are trying to do during this edition of Art Week, trying to understand how places have its own home, problems, condition, aim, condition that can be questioned with architecture as a sort of tool for being in relationship with people, other field of other disciplines, and working with the margins. So I think that it is something that we also are trying to understand and working on in these days. And your proposal for the Italian Pavilion worked in a very deep and interesting, devoted to the future way on this topic. So I leave you the floor. I thank you so much. I'm very, very happy to have you here. And Fosbury Architecture.
Hi, everyone. First of all, thanks a lot. We are extremely honored to be here tonight, right where Fosbury was born exactly 10 years ago. We are just sorry that last year the stage was ridden by a Pritzker Prize, while this year by us, but that was it, and we will do our best not to bore you. It was the year 2013 when Fosbury was born as a collective project, while some of us were still studying in this specific university, where anyway we all study and therefore met. Our aim at the time was to form a group of people that could serve as a platform to work together and to confront on theoretical subject within the larger frame of the discipline. We thought that the horizontal structure of the collective could be the best form to oppose to a labor market that seemed to reject our expectation, therefore going against the idea of the architect as a demiurge, a lonely mind on top of the design process. We're especially emotional because our very first collective project was originated here in this patio. It was a sort of manifesto in episodes called Roark, which became a fanzine printed every 2 months. A tool to scream out loud our fear as young architects, deepening reflection we felt as urgent as the time. The funny yet real story about this project referred to the fact that in order to have it printed with no funds, we made a deal with a local kebab shop so to have it printed on the back of the kebab advertisement. So finally ending up have it printed in 25,000 copies. A second occasion in which the patio acted as a stage was to display a monument to Potlatch. Potlatch was another of our early project which explored the condition of the young architect through the difficulties of the profession. In fact, starting to experience the work in offices, we felt a potential in the huge amount of work that is often discarded or forgotten. And with Potlatch, we wanted to give a second life to this overproduction into a collective project, therefore reassembling the contribution of more than 200 architects from all over the world, which from personal memorabilia could become fully accessible as a sort of open source flea market. Just to quickly introduce ourselves, since we guess not all of us know us, in the next slide we did our best in terms of synthetic summary. So first of all, let's start by saying that the formation of the group has also evolved over time, leading to changes in terms of group compositions, therefore moving from 8 members in 2013 to 5 since the 2017. As the group activities grew and changed, so did its work spaces, moving from school spaces, and again, patio, to actual offices. At the same time, following the trajectories of each member's lives, Fosbury worked from Hamburg, Rotterdam, and London, even using the spaces of the offices we were working at over the extra hours. Until 2019, we were all scattered around Europe. In fact, as a funny anecdote, this photo that was our photo opportunity for the last years is actually a collage. It was just from the 2020 that we all came back to Italy, just in time to lock ourselves in our homes during the global pandemic. Yet as soon as we've been liberated, we open a new space, actually not just ours, but together with other collectives and colleagues, as a sort of collective of collectives. A big space to allow us both to test installation and prototype one-to-one, as well as to organize public events. In the 10 years of production, for us Fosbury is and has been primarily a platform to do projects of different nature together. Like everyone, we have done competitions. Here you see some of them, which highlights different periods, from urban strategies in the beginning to architecture and small intervention later. We did and do installations, temporary pavilions, renovation, furniture design, but also labyrinths. And we are used to benefit of the writing tool as a way to reflect on our researches and interests. Among these, probably the most important one so far was Incompiuto, The Birth of the Style, published in 2018 by Humble Books and co-edited with Alterazione Video. Finally, last but not least, we happened to curate exhibitions, design setup, and took part in quite some biennials as well as group exhibitions. Speaking of exhibitions, here we are today talking about our latest one, an occasion that came almost as an unexpected birthday gift, perhaps to celebrate our 10th anniversary. An unexpected opportunity to the point that when the email arrived on February 9, 2022, a date that I believe we will never forget, for a whole day we did not react because from the few lines you can read here, we did not understand exactly what it was about. It wasn't until the next evening that we faced the thing, basically 24 hours after. And to tell the truth, we were not even sure and convinced to participate given the past bad experiences with competitions. That evening, however, happened something not so unusual to us. In fact, within a few hours, we had, a shared idea about which we were all convinced, a curatorial structure, most of the name of the people we wanted to collaborate and involve, and the title. So basically, we didn't have any more excuse not to start from the next day. So right from the start, we used this occasion as an opportunity to give voice to a generation of which we feel being part. In synthesis, in fact, as it was recalled before, we represent a generation that grew up in a permanent crisis. We enroll in university at the turn of the 2008 financial crisis, and once graduated, we look for work in a market that seemed was certainly not ready to welcome us. Finally, for the past 2 years, like everyone else, we have been confined to our homes, and at the moment, we are in the middle of an energetic and geopolitical crisis. But more particularly, we believe it will be the environmental crisis that will be the one that will increasingly impact our life, an aspect on which the construction sector has great responsibility, considering that it is one of the biggest contributors to resource consumptions and emissions. Yet, while construction sector does not seem to see a crisis, architects are less and less players in the transformations of cities and territories. And in a context like Italy, characterized by the chronic weaknesses we all know, one could almost say that architecture is experiences a crisis of relevance. As highlighted by Leslie Locco, curator of the Architecture Biennale 2023, architects, or rather spatial practices, are among the few who actually can shape new public policies and imagine different ways of living. And in this context, scarcity, net of rhetoric, is not only an opportunity, but also the only context in which it makes sense to operate. In Italy, there is a generation of practitioners who, in our opinion, have already accepted the challenge and that daily attempt to develop antibodies to disillusionment. A generation of practitioners used to make the best out of the few resources at their disposal, cultivating transdisciplinary as a means of expanding the limits of architecture towards unexplored fields. In this sense, the term spazialisti, which we use to define these practitioners, is a translation into Italian of critical spatial practices, a term coined by Jane Randall to identify those practices at the crossroads between theory and practice, public and private, art and architecture. From here, Spaziale, the main title of the exhibition, refers to an expanded notion of the field of architecture. We, in fact, believe that the discipline of architecture should not be limited to the built artifact. On the contrary, in our view, making architecture means primarily working with the space or the network of relationship between people and places at the basis of every project. We intended the Italian Pavilion as an occasion of design for the invitees, surpassing the format of the Encyclopedia exhibition, and as already mentioned, as a photograph of a generation that is trying through its daily practice to redefine what architecture means. For the first time, the Italian Pavilion becomes an opportunity to implement pioneering projects or concrete actions addressed to local communities and territories. For this reason, we use a substantial part of the budget of the public funds to trigger new processes or to enhance existing projects by addressing new chapters. Moreover, aware that temporary events of this magnitude can be particularly extractive in terms of energy and resources, we have envisioned an expanded time horizon, one that goes beyond the 6 months duration of the biennial. What we are gonna show you now, as well as what you see, or maybe you already saw in Venice, is therefore not a finished project, but the beginning of a series of initiatives that we are sure will have long-lasting impact, or at least for the territories in which we intervened. Before introducing the actors who work on the project, we want to make explicit that our role has been, on the one hand, that of facilitators between constellation of agents, and on the other, the one of promoter of a network of migrating intelligences in the service of a shared project of which we feel also part. The 9 practices that were asked to develop site-specific projects were identified on the basis of 3 main parameters: the research they carry out, the design attitude they express in their everyday practice, and the territories in which they intervene. These 9 firms represent an incomplete list of Italian practitioners whose practice lies at the perimeter of what is considered architecture. They define themselves collectives, agencies, research studio, etc. They are based in Italy and abroad, and their average is about 33 years, perhaps the youngest group ever presented at an Italian Pavilion. In order to make the project's credible transdisciplinary products, we paired each practice with an advisor or professional figures from other fields of creativity. In example, artists, performers, food or artificial intelligence expert, writer, filmmaker, etc. Each transdisciplinary group was asked to intervene in places representative of conditions of fragility or transformation along the peninsula. Places where they have already worked or to which they are related by affinity in terms of research topic, practice, or geographic area. And in order to root each project in the territory, each group collaborated with a number of incubators or local actors such as public or private association, museum, or end culture institutions. In general, let's say that the 9 projects constitute the stage of an unprecedented geography spread across the peninsula that ideally expand the boundaries of the Italian Pavilion beyond the Tese delle Vergini, therefore, in our opinion, representing for Italy a real laboratory of the future. Before going into the specific of the projects and leaving the floor to Nicola, I want to specify one last aspect mentioned quickly before, which is related to the expanded temporality. The project, in fact, was articulated into three different moments, with the first one starting in January 2023, well before the opening of the pavilion in Venice. This was Spaziale Presenta, and between January and April acted as an observatory on the 9 site-specific intervention, a phase that was documented through online and social platform so as to allow the progress of to follow the progress of the activities on the territories. The second is Spaziale, everyone belongs to everyone else, which inaugurated with the opening of the Biennale in May, will run until November, embedding within the Italian pavilion the formal and theoretical synthesis of the processes triggered in the 9 interventions in the previous months. At the same time, since May onwards, a series of other activities will continue or will start. On the one hand, the local projects in the territory will not stop or didn't stop with the opening of the Italian pavilion. On the contrary, they will continue with a dense series of activities throughout the duration of the exhibition and beyond. Not coincidentally, from tomorrow until Sunday, June 11, the project in Trieste, to which you are all invited, will be reactivated. On the other hand, in Venice, outside the biennial perimeter, accessible to everyone, and more precisely located at the Teatrino of Palazzo Grassi, we are curating the official public program of the pavilion. 5 episodes, 5 appointments over the course of the 6 months, the second of which will take place precisely on Friday 9, and we'll have Gali as guest, and please come, you are very welcome. On the occasion of the first episode instead, which took place on Saturday, May 20, so the day after the opening of the pavilion, we wanted to give voice to the actors of the catalog published by Humble Books and designed by Giga Design Studio, actually the design agency which took care of the whole visual identity of the Italian Pavilion project. Coming back to the catalog, to be honest, defining it catalog is not that appropriate. We prefer to call it just book. In fact, differently from a conventional catalog, there are no photos of the projects, but rather their processes. Each project is recounted on the one hand through an interview to each group when months ago they were still in the conception and making phases, and on the other through photographic essay of the location as they are before the activations of the interventions. So photographic essays, specifically commissioned to 9 different photographers, 1 per project, creating a heterogeneous visual collection in terms of style and language, trying each time to identify the best, the most suitable one for each place. Finally, to broaden the reflection, the last section of the book has been dedicated to a so-called reader, or critical essays written by architecture critics and scholars, such as Charlotte Malterbart, Mirko Zardini, DPR Barcelona, Anna Pujaner, Marcus Missen, and Nina Bassoli. Okay, after all these words, we now leave room to the images, a mix of photos, essays by the 9 photographers in the catalog, documenting photos by DSL Studio, and videos by Alterazioni Video. So from the next slide on, we will try to tell you in synthesis what happened in the different territories, which are, for us, the real actions of the Italian Pavilion.
Okay, so most of the project started by creating a network from scratch, planting the 4 seed. But this project we present is an enhancement of an already existing project in which we promoted our new iteration. Post-disaster transformed the rooftops of Taranto Old City into performative stages through a series of contemporary and temporary occupations. Thanks to their actions, post-disaster helped to emancipate the city from its monoculture of steel production, from Ilva. Taranto is one of the most polluted cities in Europe, and the conflict between the work and health is a long-standing issue there. For decades, it has placed workers before a blackmail to choose between the right to work and the right to breath and air, which doesn't make you sick. The rooftops are, for them, unconventional urban spaces, suspended between public and private. This project stages a program, so divided in 3 days, of ephemeral action built around spoken words, sounds, and the use of body. The first day's activities began with a Tai Chi class to make the audience becoming familiar with the body in cities like Taranto, where the relationship between body and space is really much stronger and more pressing than elsewhere. So this occupation required a very minimal architecture infrastructure in order to function. And the second act, maybe the peak, is a performance by Silvia Calderoni and Ilenia Caleo, the advisor, well-known artist of the Italian contemporary scene. The performance is contextualized with the city of Taranto by articulating itself around the liquid of the city, so the water of the sea and all the polluting substances that they retain. Eventually pouring the liquid and drawing abstract shapes on top of two carpets. In the world of Silvia and Ilenia, the performance is a very simple thing, living bodies in front of other living bodies. In this case, an audience of more than 200 people climbed on the top of the city's rooftops. But another performance followed in the streets of the old city, where paradoxically, it's impossible to tell who's this performer and who's the audience. Here, Silvia interacted with a small crowd of tourists.
A disposizione. C'era una signora che mi chiedeva del materiale, dei libricini, del materiale informativo. Potete chiedere a... Scusate, che sta succedendo? Si è fermato.
Sta meditando.
Ah, sta facendo delle riprese. Quindi potete chiedere all'interno.
While the third act is an assembly, a public discussion about coping with environmental disaster, the group stand in opposition to the Western idea of 2050 narrative that pushes the point of catastrophe forward in a predetermined technocratic future. And they were asking themselves, in Taranto, a place where the disaster has already happened, what we have learned. The second project is a collaboration between Terraforma Music Festival, which is happening these days, and Atelier BB, composed by Alessandro Bava, Fabrizio Balladio, which are both from Campania. The Bay of Yeranto is an inlet of the Sorrentine Peninsula. This place has a mythological past, being the setting of a famous episode of the Greek mythology. In fact, it was the place where, according to the Odyssey, Ulysses was bewitched by the song of the sirens during his return to Ithaca. But this place also has an industrial past, which connects us with the project in Taranto. In fact, the area was used as a quarry to extract limestone that served in Bagnoli steel industry, the Italsider again. These images show the effect of these extractive policies, a bite in the bay that is evidence of 500,000 cubic meters of extracted rock. These images come from the Ilva steel industry in Bagnoli, a district in the periphery of Naples, which was formerly a thermal spot since ancient times, and now look like this. The quarry closed in the 50s, and since 1985, the area has been protected by FAI, Il Fondo Ambiente, which is implementing an environmental restoration to recover the original Mediterranean scrub. A locus amenus, where time has remained suspended, as you can see, Alberto from Alterazzi di Vido is showing us, sleeping peacefully under an olive tree. Due to the nature of the place, any intervention in the area can only be ephemeral, non-intrusive, and completely reversible. So BB and Terraforma come up with a very light single-day program. Center around the figure of Walter Maioli, which is a musician, a composer, and archaeologist of sound. For over 40 years, his research about sound and music focused on rediscovery of ancient soundscape. In the picture, you can see some of the musical instruments used that day, including shells and many instruments of his own invention. Here you can hear some extracts from the soundcheck of the his Posidonia Orchestra. While Atelier BB studied a set design that echoes the form of Neapolitan Baroque by creating a white niche made of fiberglass entirely transported by sea. At the end of the day, Walter Maioli performed in close dialogue with the niche and the architectural structure of the bay, evoking its mythological past. And according to the new mythology, the performance was suddenly interrupted by a storm. A new chapter will be implemented in the next months with the educational program of the Madre Museum. The third project features the collaboration of the designer Giuditta Vendrame from Friuli but resident in the Netherlands and Anna Shametai, the field director and producer of Albanian origins, and investigates the border territory between Italy and Slovenia, placing the epicenter of the project in Trieste. The border has always been a place of passage and transit, and even today is one of the main migration spots to Europe, being the last leg of the Balkan route, which is a constant point of contact with other cultures and rendered the city and the territory a very stratified place, a mixture which is manifest by recipes, popular song, and the harshness of the dialect. To approach this contextual complexity, the participants decided to look at this expanded territory through the lens of music. They look at sounds as a landscape, as a channel to cross the borders. And the title of the project is Sot Glas, Sot from the Friulan for under, and Glas from the Slovenian for voice. The intervention in Trieste ran along this place, which is called Kleine Berlin, 500 meters of underground tunnels, and a shelter built during the Second World War, which is in the center of the city, but almost neglected, to the point that even people from Trieste doesn't know about its existence. The specific site chosen is the Italian section of the tunnels, where nature is reappropriating the space. So the poor quality of the cement allowed water to infiltrate, forming evocative stalactites from the ceiling and pisolites from the floor. The result is a sound and light installation where the movement of visitors in the space unravels into a plurality of voices from past to present. The audio ranges from bilingual songs to short poems of resistance, from verses of immigration to lullabies. And the installation also has extremely pragmatic implication, as the expanded design team was also responsible of the restoring of the tunnel's electrical system and the redoing of the catwalks that allows the local caving association to work more easily among the tunnels. Just these days, Judith and Anna, as Claudia was mentioning, organized a public opening of the space, and we last until June 11, so you are strongly invited, and it's really worth it to visit. So 4 years, together with Attorazioni Video, we have been dealing with the phenomenon of unfinished public works in Italy, which culminated in the publication of a book, as Claudia was again mentioning. However, we have always felt that beyond the publication, the topic could have been explored more in a more operative way, and we are very happy to challenge other talented design group as HPO from Ferrara and the writer Claudia Durastanti to work on that. The project is located in Ripateatina, an inland municipality in Abruzzo, in the province of Chieti, and we are talking about a very small village, about 4,000 inhabitants, quite forgotten, where it not for the fact that it was the birthplace of the parents, the famous boxing champion Rocky Marciano, who then immigrated to the United States. But this land also welcomed an unfinished public work, a never-to-be-completed hospital, started in 1973. 50 years have passed since that day, during which there has been many projects of completion and many hypotheses of demolition. Despite its incompleteness, the building looks lovely to us and looks like a gently landed spaceship, now completely blended with the vegetation. After the municipality surprisingly obtained a time loan use from the property, HPO began to study the artifacts carefully and to understand how to make it safely accessible. Starting in the first place with the micro intervention of improvement to accessibility and safety with some selective demolitions. But it's from this aerial view you can see that the project takes shape in an approach similar to a land art piece. The name of the project is Uccellaccio, which is reminiscent to the famous geoglyphs in Nazca. A large circular walkway surrounds the unfinished building make it possible to walk around it. And basically, by walking along this path, it is finally impossible to ignore the strategic geographical position of the building and the fact that it is an excellent place to observe the landscape compressed between the Gran Sasso and the sea. The activation then culminated with an official inauguration of the Uccellaccio Park, aimed to a pacification with the community and the municipality, finally capable of taming with the eco monster. We also wanted a project close to Venice, so we chose to deal with the logistical counterpart of the Serenissima, the mainland, and specifically to Marghera. We are talking about a very fragmented periphery characterized by disused factories, pollution, unemployment, and social disgregation. Here, Parasite and Elia Fornari look at this landscape as a sort of a urban wilderness, taking inspiration from Andrea Branzi's concept of primitive metropolis. The project is titled Concrete Jungle and investigates the relationship between nature and artifice. The project comes together with a wonderful discovery, a very beautiful story. In Marghera in 1997, a priest parish and a group of climbing enthusiasts founded the Sgrafa Masegna Association, allowing to install on the lateral side of the church, La Chiesa del Gesù Lavoratore, a series of vaults, making it climbable. Since then, the area around the church has been a spot of social interaction, of inclusive and non-competitive sport activities. This project fits very humbly in this context by supporting the association activities and replacing all the olds that were worn out by the intense use over the years. So a professional road setter, a legend among the climber community, designed a series of new climbing roads to be used. And we have witnessed the functioning of it during Arampilandia, which is the annual patron saint event, with almost 1,000 children climbing. And here you can see Stefano from Parasite engage in some interviews with children, reflecting on the relationship between humans and artifacts and nature. The answers are as profound as hilarious, and you can see the final result in a short movie displayed in the Biennale. This project explored the food transition, a topic that may seem far from architecture, I know, but which actually has huge effect on space and on the territory. So the authors are Lemonot and Roberto Flore, the director in Copenhagen of one of the most important laboratories for the future of nutrition. The project is located in Cabras Lagoon on the Sinis Peninsula, a place known just for the production of Botarga, the mullet roe. The Botarga is not just an ingredient there, but something that binds together the local community and its history. To talk about food transition, the authors reveal us that it's not possible to take into account only the final product, but we have to know and work with the entire ecosystem that is producing this product, being it social, environmental, or economic. So the increasing demand of Botarga in recent years has meant that local fishing quantities were not sufficient anymore, and large amounts of roe starts to be imported from the Mediterranean Sea and the Atlantic. And of course, that has ecological footprint that has increased by far. And the installation took place in this small place, in this chiesetta, called Chiesetta di San Vincenzo, within the Peschiera Mare Pontis, the very ancient one, and represent an abstract topography located on the floor of the small church, composed of more than 500 cones of salt and 12 terracotta sculptures. Was materiality somehow summons the fundamental elements of the pond, so the salt and the roe. All this culture, you can see, are now part of an auction, so you can buy it, where the revenues will be collected to support them. Integrated research fund for the region. Speaking about peripheries, which is the core topic of this artwork, let me present you the project by Studio Ossidiana and Adelita Usnibei, which is an artist and pedagogist. And as you probably know, Librino is a district in the city of Catania, designed as an ideal new town by the Japanese metabolist architect Kenzo Tange, whose master plan has remained partly incomplete. And today, after 50 years of neglect and degradation, the neighborhood have seen a phenomenon of social unease, urban decay related to common and organized crimes. But Librino is also the largest child population. I welcome also the largest child population in Catania. So we decided to start from the efforts and the work of one of the many associations that contributes to create spaces of aggregation for them. Talita Kum Association is the after school of more than 200 local children. So immediately listening to their desire of this community, on the one hand, Adelita Usnibei developed side by side with the children a role play game built around the symbols and the mythologies of the neighborhood called The Great Game of Librino. And on the other hand, Ossidiana developed La Casa Tappeto, or the Soft Palace, which is a mobile pavilion that copes a collective need for shade, protection, and lightness. These images show the first activation. It all is in a process of refinements. We think that it can be an enriching addition to their activities. And this project, as well as the one in Taranto, implements and fit into an existing project. Belmonte is a small town located in the Calabria hinterland, and on top, it's on top of a panoramic position overlooking the Tyrrhenian Sea. The small town, like many of the inland areas, suffer a process of depopulation. But there's a group called La Rivoluzione delle Seppie, which since 2016 began this process of revitalization of the territory by means of cultural activities and architectural renovation scattered all over the small town. Orizzontale are part of this network, and this image shows their quarter, which is this glorious Casa Belmondo, which is the epicenter of all their activities. In this new episode, promoted by the Biennale, the group decided to take care of another space, which is the garden of an ancient castle, which has been largely abandoned for decades. And on the one end, a very pragmatic work of removing weed vegetation, securing pathways, and creating a series of architectural devices offered a new possibility to enjoy the space. On the other end, thanks to the work of the advisor, Bruno Zamborlin, which is an AI researcher, this furniture has been augmented by means of a vibration sensor, and they become a proper musical instruments. This interaction, in a way, led to a new form of active listening and participation between the space and the inhabitants, and helping to raise a new form of playfulness and a local awareness of this space. The program lasted for a week and was enriched by workshops with children focusing on the garden native vegetation, but also public presentation and a concert that culminated in this beautiful cistern you can see on the right, set up by Orizzontale with a bonfire and a stage. And this is the latest project, and last but not least, and which takes a critical look at the extreme protection and preservation of our landscape. The project sits in the heart of the Piana di Firenze Prato Pistoia and investigates the place of production of the typical pastoral idyll of the Tuscany. Following the idea of truth and authenticity, which is an obsession of our recent time, this imagery has been constantly reproduced to sell a tourist image of this countryside, a model which is so fascinating, which is exported worldwide. So the project by Abnormal Captcha Emilio Bavarella starts by revealing how codified and calculated is this kind of diorama by showing its backroom, so how it's produced. This landscape is composed by two main assets. Firstly, the landscape is produced by one of the largest nursery districts in Europe, which is this matrix in which all the plants are divided by essences, height, color, and lushness. And on the second end, they notice the production of a series of decorative elements which are produced by small companies that use to translate traditional geometries into replicable formulas. They look like stone made, but are instead made of polystyrene, cut by numerically controlled machine and in highly computer assist processes. So the project work as an occupation of the nursery district, and experiments with a new form of tourism, pushing the idea of inhabiting this space. This is some picture of the field occupation in a very unfortunately rainy day. Lastly, at Centro Pecci, a museum of contemporary art, the project takes the form of a digital belvedere, which is a metal structure where the video mapping of the surrounding region can be enjoyed, and we lately welcome the public program organized directly by the participants and the museum itself. So all this project investigates a new form of a public space, shifting the gaze to neglected or unexpected spaces, and once again changing the hierarchies between the center and the periphery. The project intends to broaden the concept of the public space, which for us can be found in the lateral side of a church, in a World War II bunker, or in the roof of a city. And finally, we come to the pavilion, and I will briefly introduce our choices, hoping that you will have the chance to visit it directly in Venice. So at the entrance, we are greeted by this curtain, and which obscured the visit and the view of the interior. And if you are wondering, we are not the responsible for the removing of Chinozuki's Archimbuto. On the contrary, we loved it. So this is the floor plan of the pavilion, which, as you probably know, is by far the largest of all the national pavilions, which is divided into two spaces of equal area. So how to occupy this massive amount of space? We have chosen to open the exhibition with a big void. So half of the huge space given to us, which was a nightmare for all our predecessors, was left vacant. So making manifest with that half of the exhibition and half of the public funds were elsewhere, all over the Italy. So this gesture is not just symbolic to make our strategy very manifest, but also a special gesture. So showing the space empty for the first time allows us to appreciate its special qualities. So the original floor, the overhead crane, the truss, and so on and so forth. So the exhibition opened with a video projected that summarized all what happened before, so the rules of the game and all the players involved. And we can enter in by two portals on the second space, which is a completely different environment, which houses together in comparison all the works of the exhibition. We go back to the floor plan to notice the white squares, which are the space occupied by the works, and a hyper-simplified map of Italy, you can say it. Italy is squeezed from north to south, bringing together its two extremes. This template is marked on the ground, and it's a kind of Dogville-like atmosphere that aids the navigation. So the navigation of the space is very open, with no walls, rooms, or vertical interruptions, so that you can see and enjoy the view of the space in its entirety. So.
Okay, so how to translate the project which happened outside in the territories within the pavilion? We try to identify a few strategies, and each installation has found a particular way to translate what has been done outside in the previous months. Some appears completely dematerialized. It is the case of SOT class, the project in Trieste, where the authors decided to favor the sound elements over the visual one, where 16 speakers arranged in a circle produce an immersive polyphonic sound environment. Among the speakers, there is a special one, which is actually a sonic cannon. The sonic cannon is a weapon generally used to disorient the migrant at sea. And reversing the use, in this case, the participants, the artist decided to hack and somehow to disarm the cannon, instead of releasing it with high frequencies, it plays a Pashtun lullaby. Moving to the installation related to Taranto, it is an assemblage of mixed media which have been used in Taranto and then transported here. So you can maybe recognize the carpet, the foam stools, and we, together with thanks to the speaker, try to reproduce the sounds recorded over the days of the activation. HPO, together with Claudia Durastanti, as a sort of allegory, decided to synthesize its action on the unfinished building into a pile of debris and a two-phase medallion, where on one side a graphic showed the blueprint of the intervention, and on the other side a textual glossary of evocative terms chosen by Claudia Durastanti refers to the process of rereading of the Ecomoster. Differently from the previous three cases, there are other installations which adopted instead a more pragmatic strategy. It is the case of Parasite and Ilia Fornari with the project Concrete Jungle, with used precast concrete tubes transformed into climbable elements, a structure which, once the biennial will be finished, will be dismantled and relocated to Marghera as a bouldering structure for the children. In the case of the project for Librino, instead of Sediana, transported the tent, which then will also come back to Sicily once the biennale will be finished. And it is shown in the pavilion in one of its possible configuration. Under it, instead, it has been placed an illustrative version of the great game of Librino conceived by the artist Adelita Unzdimei together with Talita Kum Association. In the case of the project of the Baia di Eranto, the installation evokes the experience of the performance that took place on site by mainly three elements. The original niche scenography, which was directly transported from the bay and reassembled in the pavilion, the music instruments, and the music record, The Sound of the Bees, by Walter Maioli and published by Villa Lontana. Finally, in other cases, the strategy adopted by the installation in the pavilion is the one of a reenactment of the on-site project. It is the case of the project by Lemonot and Roberto Flore, titled Sea Changes, and which recompose the plan of the small church San Vincenzo on a one-to-one scale, together with all the sculpture, which, as mentioned earlier by Nicola, will be on auction for the whole duration of the Biennale. It is also the case of Abnormal, Capcia and Emilio Babarella, who offer a formal synthesis of the techno-aesthetic style of the Tuscan productive landscape. Finally, with an even different strategy, Orizzontale and Bruno Zamborlin invite visitors to interact with three simple structures, augmented thanks to vibrating sensors, so enriching the images and sounds recorded in Belmonte. Lastly, yet maybe the most important support of the installation in Venice are the two projections that close the short side of the second space. It is a generative video installation that collects more than 1,000 clips that Alterazione Video has collected documenting the nine open construction sites. Following this, thanks to the collaboration with Fantamagico, the recording were processed through a generative algorithm, so to recall each other, reconstructing a singular choral narrative. In the center, you see some phrases which we extracted from the interviews to the participants that are inserted in the catalog, which become the thematic engine that make one or another image appear. It is therefore a continuous non-linear elaboration where places, authors, and community blur together, forming a wall. So images, text, sounds flow across the screen like an endless stream, making each visit to the pavilion unique. It was for us, in fact, crucial to see all the projects communicating together once again, creating association and finding common traits in this renovated way of conceiving architecture, once again imagining a future in which everyone belongs to everyone else. Thank you.